Harper Perennial and Harper Audio present Sharpe's Triumph, Richard Sharpe and the Battle of Assaye, September 1803, by Bernard Cornwell, performed by Rupert Farley.
Chapter 1. It was not Sergeant Richard Sharpe's fault. He was not in charge. He was junior to at least a dozen men, including a major, a captain, a subedar, and two jemadars, yet he still felt responsible. He felt responsible, angry, hot, bitter, and scared. Blood crusted on his face where a thousand flies crawled. There were even flies in his open mouth, but he dared not move. The humid air stank of blood and of the rotted egg smell made by powder smoke. The very last thing he remembered doing was thrusting his pack, haversack and cartridge box into the glowing ashes of a fire, and now the ammunition from the cartridge box exploded. Each blast of powder fountained sparks and ashes into the hot air. A couple of men laughed at the sight. They stopped to watch it for a few seconds, poked at the nearby bodies with their muskets, then walked on. Sharpe lay still. A fly crawled on his eyeball and he forced himself to stay absolutely motionless. There was blood on his face and more blood had puddled in his right ear, though it was drying now. He blinked, fearing that the small motion would attract one of the killers, but no one noticed. Chasselgowan. That's where he was. Chasselgowan. A miserable, thorn-walled fort on the frontier of Hyderabad. And because the Raja of Hyderabad was a British ally, the fort had been garrisoned by 100 sepoys of the East India Company and 50 mercenary horsemen from Mysore. Only when Sharpe arrived, half the sepoys and all of the horsemen had been out on patrol. Sharpe had come from Seringapatam, leading a detail of 6 privates and carrying a leather bag stuffed with rupees, and he'd been greeted by Major Crosby, who commanded at Chasselgowan. The major proved to be a plump, red-faced, bilious man who disliked the heat and hated Chasselgowan, and he had slumped in his canvas chair as he unfolded Sharpe's orders. He read them, grunted, then read them again.
"Why the hell did they send you?"
he finally asked.
"No one else to send, sir."
Crosby frowned at the order.
"Why not an officer?"
"No officers to spare, sir."
"Bloody responsible job for a sergeant, wouldn't you say?"
"Won't let you down, sir," Sharpe said woodenly, staring at the leprous yellow of the tense canvas a few inches above the major's head.
"You'd bloody well better not let me down,"
Crosby said, pushing the orders into a pile of damp papers on his camp table.
"And you look bloody young to be a sergeant."
"I was born late, sir," Sharpe said.
He was 26, or thought he was, and most sergeants were much older. Crosby, suspecting he was being mocked, stared up at Sharpe, but there was nothing insolent on the sergeant's face. A good-looking man, Crosby thought, sourly. Probably had the bibbies of Seringapatam falling out of their saris, and Crosby, whose wife had died of the fever 10 years before, and who consoled himself with a 2-rupee village whore every Thursday night, felt a pang of jealousy.
"And how the devil do you expect to get the ammunition back to Seringapatam?" he demanded.
"Hire ox carts, sir."
Sharpe had long perfected the way to address unhelpful officers. He gave them precise answers, added nothing unnecessary, and always sounded confident.
"With what? Promises?"
"Money, sir."
Sharpe tapped his haversack, where he had the bag of rupees.
"Christ, they trust you with money?"
Sharpe decided not to respond to that question, but just stared impassively at the canvas. Chasselgowan, he decided, was not a happy place. It was a small fort built on a bluff above a river that should have been overflowing its banks, but the monsoon had failed and the land was cruelly dry. The fort had no ditch, merely a wall made of cactus thorn with a dozen wooden fighting platforms spaced about its perimeter. Inside the wall was a beaten earth parade ground, where a stripped tree served as a flagpole, and the parade ground was surrounded by three mud-walled barracks thatched with palm, a cookhouse, tents for the officers, and a stone-walled magazine to store the garrison's ammunition. The sepoys had their families with them, so the fort was overrun with women and children. But Sharpe had noted how sullen they were. Crosby, he thought, was one of those crabbed officers who were only happy when all about them were miserable.
"I suppose you expect me to arrange the ox carts," Crosby said indignantly.
"I'll do it myself, sir."
"Speak the language, do you?" Crosby sneered. "A sergeant banker and interpreter, are you?"
"Brought an interpreter with me, sir," Sharpe said,
which was over-egging the pudding a bit, because Davy Lal was only 13, an urchin off the streets of Seringapatam. He was a smart, mischievous child, whom Sharpe had found stealing from the armory cookhouse. After giving the starving boy a clout around both ears to teach him respect for His Britannic Majesty's property, Sharpe had taken him to Lally's house and given him a proper meal. And Lally had talked to the boy and learnt that his parents were dead, that he had no relatives he knew of, and that he lived by his wits. He was also covered in lice.
"Get rid of him," she had advised Sharpe.
But Sharpe had seen something of his own childhood in Davy Lal, and so he had dragged him down to the River Corvery and given him a decent scrubbing. After that, Davy Lal had become Sharpe's errand boy. He learned to pipe clay belts, blackball boots, and speak his own version of English, which, because it came from the lower ranks, was liable to shock the gentler born.
"You'll need three carts," Crosby said.
"Yes, sir," Sharpe said. "Thank you, sir."
He had known exactly how many carts he would need, but he also knew it was stupid to pretend to knowledge in the face of officers like Crosby.
"Find your damned carts," Crosby snapped. "Then let me know when you're ready to load up."
"Very good, sir. Thank you, sir."
Sharpe stiffened to attention, about turned, and marched from the tent to find Davy Lal and the six privates waiting in the shade of one of the barracks.
"We'll have dinner," Sharpe told them, "then sort out some carts this afternoon."
"What's for dinner?"
Private Atkins asked.
"Whatever Davy can filch from the cookhouse," Sharpe said. "But be nippy about it, all right? I want to be out of this damn place tomorrow morning."
Their job was to fetch 80,000 rounds of prime musket cartridges that had been stolen from the East India Company armory in Madras. The cartridges were the best quality in India, and the thieves who stole them knew exactly who would pay the highest price for the ammunition. The princedoms of the Maratha Confederation were forever at war with each other, or else raiding the neighbouring states. But now, in the summer of 1803, they faced an imminent invasion by British forces. The threatened invasion had brought two of the biggest Maratha rulers into an alliance that now gathered its forces to repel the British. And those rulers had promised the thieves a king's ransom in gold for the cartridges. But one of the thieves, who had helped break into the Madras armory, had refused to let his brother join the band and share in the profit, and so the aggrieved brother had betrayed the thieves to the company's spies. And 2 weeks later, the caravan carrying the cartridges across India had been ambushed by sepoys not far from Chasselgowan. The thieves had died or fled, and the recaptured ammunition had been brought back to the fort's small magazine for safekeeping. Now the 80,000 cartridges were to be taken to the armory at Seringapatam, 3 days to the south, from where they would be issued to the British troops, who were readying themselves for the war against the Mahrattas. A simple job, and Sharpe, who had spent the last 4 years as a sergeant in the Seringapatam armory, had been given the responsibility. Spoilage, Sharpe was thinking, while his men boiled a cauldron of river water on a bullock dung fire. That was the key to the next few days. Spoilage. Say, 7,000 cartridges lost to damp? No one in Seringapatam would argue with that, and Sharpe reckoned he could sell the 7,000 cartridges on to Vakil Hussein, so long, of course, as there were 80,000 cartridges to begin with. Still, Major Crosby had not quibbled with the figure, but just as Sharpe was thinking that, so Major Crosby appeared from his tent with a cocked hat on his head and a sword at his side.
"On your feet!"
Sharpe snapped at his lads as the Major headed towards them.
"Thought you were finding ox carts," Crosby snarled at Sharpe.
"Dinner first, sir."
"Your food, I hope, and not ours. We don't get rations to feed King's troops here, Sergeant."
Major Crosby was in the service of the East India Company, and though he wore a red coat like the King's army, there was little love lost between the two forces.
"Our food, sir,"
Sharpe said, gesturing at the cauldron, in which rice and kid meat, both stolen from Crosby's stores, boiled.
"Carried it with us, sir."
A havildar shouted from the fort gate, demanding Crosby's attention, but the Major ignored the shout.
"I forgot to mention one thing, Sergeant."
"Sir?"
Crosby looked sheepish for a moment, then remembered he was talking to a mere sergeant.
"Some of the cartridges were spoiled. Damp got to them."
"I'm sorry to hear that, sir,"
Sharpe said, straight-faced.
"So I had to destroy them," Crosby said. 6,000 or 7,000, as I remember."
"Spoilage, sir," Sharpe said. "Happens all the time, sir."
"Exactly so,"
Crosby said, unable to hide his relief at Sharpe's easy acceptance of his tale.
"Exactly so."
Then he turned towards the gate.
"Havildar?"
"Company troops approaching, Sahib."
"Where's Captain Leonard? Isn't he officer of the day?"
Crosby demanded.
"Here, sir, I'm here."
A tall, gangling captain hurried from a tent, tripped on a guy rope, recovered his hat, then headed for the gate. Sharpe ran to catch up with Crosby, who was also walking towards the gate.
"You'll give me a note, sir?"
"A note? Why the devil should I give you a note?"
"Spoilage, sir," Sharpe said respectfully. "I'll have to account for the cartridges, sir."
"Later," Crosby said. "Later."
"Yes, sir,"
Sharpe said. "And sod you backwards, you miserable bastard," he added, though too softly for Crosby to hear. Captain Leonard clambered up to the platform beside the gate where Crosby joined him. The Major took a telescope from his tail pocket and slid the tubes open. The platform overlooked the small river that should have been swollen by the seasonal rains into a flood, but the failure of the monsoon had left only a trickle of water between the flat grey rocks. Beyond the shrunken river, up on the skyline behind a grove of trees, Crosby could see red-coated troops, led by a European officer mounted on a black horse. And his first thought was that it must be Captain Roberts, returning from patrol. But Roberts had a piebald horse, and besides, he had only taken 50 sepoys, whereas this horseman led a company almost twice that size.
"Open the gate,"
Crosby ordered, and wondered who the devil it was. He decided it was probably Captain Sullivan from the company's post at Milladar, another frontier fort like Chasselgowan. But what the hell was Sullivan doing here? Maybe he was marching some new recruits to toughen the bastards. Not that the skinny little brutes needed any toughening, but it was uncivil of Sullivan not to warn Crosby of his coming.
"Jemadar!"
Crosby shouted.
"Turn out the guard!"
"Sahib!"
The Jemadar acknowledged the order. Other sepoys were dragging the thorn gates open. "He'll want dinner," Crosby thought sourly, and wondered what his servants were cooking for the midday meal. Kid probably in boiled rice. Well, Sullivan would just have to endure the stringy meat as a price for not sending any warning, and damn the man if he expected Crosby to feed his sepoys as well.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.